The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Luke. That very day, the first day of the week, two of Jesus' disciples were going to a village 7 miles from Jerusalem called Emmaus, and they were conversing about all the things that had occurred. And it happened that while they were conversing and debating, Jesus himself drew near and walked with them, but their eyes were prevented from recognizing him. He asked them, "What are you discussing along the way?" They stopped, looking downcast. One of them, named Cleopas, said to him in reply, "Are you the only visitor to Jerusalem who does not know of the things that have taken place there in these days?" And he replied to them, "What sort of things?" They said to him, "The things that happened to Jesus the Nazarene, who was a prophet, mighty in deed and word before God and all the people, how our chief priests and rulers both handed him over to a sentence of death and crucified him. But we were hoping that he would be the one to redeem Israel. And besides all this, it is now the third day since this took place. Some women from our group, however, astounded us. They were at the tomb early this morning and did not find his body. They came back and reported that they had seen a vision of angels who announced that he was alive. Then some of those with us went to the tomb and found things just as the women had described, but him they did not see." And he said to them, "Oh, how foolish you are! How slow of heart to believe all that the prophets spoke! Was it not necessary that the Christ should suffer these things and enter into his glory?" Then, beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he interpreted to them what referred to him in all the scriptures. As they approached the village to which they were going, he gave the impression that he was going on further, but they urged him, "Stay with us, for it is nearly evening, and the day is almost over." So he went in to stay with them. And it happened that while he was with them at table, he took bread, said the blessing, broke it, and gave it to them. With that, their eyes were opened, and they recognized him, but he vanished from their sight. Then they said to each other, "Were not our hearts burning within us while he spoke to us on the way and opened the scriptures to us?" So they set out at once and returned to Jerusalem, where they found gathered together the 11 and those with them who were saying, "The Lord has truly been raised and has appeared to Simon." Then the two recounted what had taken place on the way, and now he was made known to them in the breaking of the bread. The Gospel of the Lord. I've always liked that gospel. There's a lot in there. That gospel in particular reminds me of Superman. It truly does. I'm a huge fan of Superman, if you didn't already know that. You thought I was going to say Star Wars, didn't you? But no, not today. Today it's Superman. I love the way he flies around and saves people, and you know, he's this great, big, huge, strong, covered with huge muscles, not unlike myself, you know? I'm wearing my Superman underoos right now, as a matter of fact. But there's one thing I could never understand about Superman, kind of bugs me. It's Lois Lane, his girlfriend, who's supposed to be this really smart reporter, can't tell that Clark Kent is Superman, that they're the same person. Now what's up with that? And why? What brilliant disguise has Clark Kent devised to hide his identity? Glasses. Gotta be the worst disguise I've ever heard, right? Glasses. Like, how does this work for you? Check this out, watch this. Hey, where did Father Mike go? Oh, there he is, look at that, huh? Of course you weren't fooled by that. Of course not. What kind of reporter must Lois Lane be? I mean, she must work for the Edmonton Sun or something like that, I don't know. The funny thing is, in the Bible, the disciples never recognized that Jesus is Jesus either after he rose. Mary Magdalene didn't recognize him at the empty tomb. Peter didn't recognize him when he was in the fishing boat. We'll hear that story another time. And in today's gospel, we've got two disciples who walk 7 miles with Jesus and have no idea who he is. What's up with that? Wasn't it the same Jesus? Didn't he look the same? Maybe he had his glasses on. I don't know. But of course, in the case of Superman, it was more than just his glasses. Lois Lane is also blinded by her expectations. She was blinded by what she thought Superman was. Big, burly, strong, powerful superhero who's bigger than life, can leap tall buildings in a single bound. Clark Kent, he's just this mild-mannered, humble, meek, wimpy loser. Ordinary guy. Nothing like what Lois would call a Superman. So she misses him. And of course, the disciples didn't really realize or recognize Jesus as the Messiah before his death either, did they? Didn't realize what he really was. They were blinded by their expectations too, just like Lois, of what they thought a Messiah was supposed to be, which is a king, mighty and powerful, with a great big sword and a flowing cape, and is huge and monstrous like Arnold Schwarzenegger, rich and powerful as Donald Trump, and handsomely good looking as Father Michael Moreau. That's not great looking. They knew he was something special because he was an amazing preacher and he kept doing miracles all the time, but he kept doing things that didn't make any sense to them. Like he hung out with sinners. Messiahs aren't supposed to do that. Or he touched lepers or went to the homes of pagans. Messiahs don't do that either. And he was poor and humble and he was nonviolent. That's not like a Messiah. And he was crucified. Messiahs definitely don't get crucified, not according to the disciples. So they never understood him either, not until after. They never recognized Jesus for who he actually was, not a guy sent to save Israel from the Romans in 1st century AD, but the guy sent to save the entire human race for all time from their sins. They never got it quite right. They were blinded by their expectations. But there's one other thing that I also think blinded them, in addition to their expectations. It's their grief. Grief can also blind us sometimes, make us irrational, keep us from seeing God, who's sometimes right in front of us. I remember once, I was about 8 years old, and I was in swimming lessons, working on my orange badge. You know, that's a very important badge to get there. Most important badge in the world, I thought. You get the orange badge, very impressive badge, which was the second badge you get. The first one you get, yellow. To get an orange badge, you had to do some amazing acrobatic, gymnastic, athletic feats of swimming techniques like float, you know? Do the doggy paddle for 5 whole meters, hold your breath underwater, that sort of thing, you know, very technical stuff, very athletic stuff. Yellow badge, that's easy. If you can get into your bathtub without a life jacket, you can get a yellow badge. Anybody can get one of those. Those are no big deal at all. And I knew that too. So I worked and worked and worked to get my orange badge. I practiced my floating on my mattress, on my bed. I held my breath at the drinking fountain at school. I walked around my house like a dog in order to get the doggy paddle down. I worked and I worked and I worked. And then at the last class, when all the kids line up to see the teacher to find out if they passed or not, get the report cards, I was called up last. Uh-oh. And when I got to the teacher, she gave me my report card, and there stapled on the top of the card was my shiny new badge. Yellow. I was devastated. Went home crying and sobbing, and I would not be consoled. My parents tried so hard to make me feel better. Here, have some ice cream, Michael's. Chocolate's your favorite. Oh, I hate chocolate ice cream. And we invited all your friends to come over and play with you, Michael. I don't want to play with them. We just booked a trip to Disneyland, Michael. I hate Disneyland. Nothing would work. My grief and my humiliation had made me completely irrational. Sometimes that's what grief does. The only thing that would have made me feel better would have been to get my orange badge. And darn it, someday I'm going to get that orange badge too, so help me God. Doggy paddles are tricky, okay? Don't give me a hard time. But grief does that. Grief can make us temporarily insane. All of us. There's no exceptions here. Another example that I remember was a lady at Good Shepherd Parish who had a very tragic situation. I remember this was about 10 years ago. She was a mother of three small children, a three-year-old and two twin babies just born, and her husband died of cancer. So she was left all alone to take care of these three kids by herself, and her relatives lived far away. Well, that really touched a lot of the people in the parish. They really felt touched by that, so they rallied to help her. Babysitting, helping her around the house. And they always brought over these casseroles to her every day. Casserole, 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 casserole. Until one particular day when whoever it was bringing a casserole over to him, guess what she did? She barked at them. Ah, you're bringing me another casserole? Ah, I'm getting sick of these casseroles. Well, the parishioners couldn't believe it. They didn't know what to do, you know? How ungrateful could she be, they thought, you know? So some of the folks came to talk to me. They said, Michael, what do we do, you know? We're just trying to be nice to her, and all we get is this grief, all this anger. I said, well, yeah, of course she's angry. Her husband died, and she's got to raise her three kids all by herself. Well, don't you think she should be thankful? No, I don't think she should be thankful. She's in too much pain. She's feeling too much anger. Now, your ministry to her today was that she got to take out some of that anger on you. So, way to go. Good job. And I tried to explain that to them, that intense grief can make us temporarily insane. And that's a fact. It applies to all of us. There's nothing wrong with it. No exceptions here. It happens to everybody. It makes us completely irrational. But what that means is that she's not going to be able to recognize Jesus when he's right in front of her through those parishioners taking care of her. Not until she heals a bit anyway. She won't be able to see it. We often won't be able to see it either when we're drowning in grief. And Jesus is right next to us helping us out. Later, we can see it once the anger is gone. So I told those parishioners, just keep loving her, keep bringing over the casseroles, and she'll come around eventually. And it's the same thing with our disciples. They're suffering a tremendous loss. All their hopes and all their dreams and all their beliefs have been crucified. Right up there on the cross, right next to Jesus, their hero, their best friend. It says right in the gospel today, they look downcast, staring at the ground. Their grief has blinded them just as much as their expectations. So, how do we get people to come around to see Jesus? How do we get ourselves to come around, recognize that Jesus is here? Well, this may come as a shock to you, but sometimes people don't automatically, immediately recognize that I am a priest. I know it's shocking, I know, but it's true. Sometimes I go into an HMV or a Best Buy or even 7-Eleven dressed in my jean jacket and my floppy hat and my shirt that's tucked in on only one side, whatever, you know, and my t-shirt that says whatever on it, as a matter of fact. And I walk in there, and as soon as I walk in, I get these funny looks from the security guard as I walk past, you know, as though I'm going to slip a DVD player into my back pocket. And at the same time, they never come over to help me to see if I need any help, you know? Like, I have to go track someone down. Excuse me, I want to buy a digital camera. They look at me, perhaps you should try Value Village or something like that, okay? And I get the same looks when I go into the hospitals to anoint people. I head into the room, person's lying there in the bed feeling terrible. And I said, hi there. And they look at me nervous. Like I'm there to steal their painkillers or something. And I say, I'm the priest. I'm here to give you the sacrament of the sick. They say, you're the priest? Yeah, I am. am. No, you're not. Yes, I am. Even with my collar on, they don't believe me. You're, it's a Halloween costume. Get out of here. No, it's me. I'm a priest. But then I talk to them for a while. I get them to open up, talk about their pain, show them some compassion, give them a little love. And then I give them the sacrament. So I give them a lot of love, God's love. And by the time I'm done, they know, hey, he is a priest. They just had to adjust their expectations, that's all. Expectations that had blinded them. As Yoda, the Jedi Master, once said,
you must unlearn what you have learned.
Smart guy, huh? Yeah, I know. I thought about this when I turned on the TV one day about 6 years ago to watch the Pope's funeral, Pope John Paul II, maybe you remember. There were all the world's leaders and all the cardinals with all their robes and their smells and their bells and their glorious music, just a hurricane of pomp and circumstance and glorification. And I was looking around there and I said, well, where's the Pope? I don't see him anywhere. Where is he? You know? And finally I found him. Oh, there he is, right in the middle. This little wooden coffin, this little pine box, the simplest, most humble thing you could ever see. It looked like something you buy in a garage sale for crying out loud. It was just so simple. And as soon as I saw it, I said, there he is. There's the presence of Christ. There's our Holy Father. It was so clear to the chanting crowds who surrounded the papal mass there, shouting out, Sancto Subito, Sancto Subito, Sancto Subito, which I think means either make him a saint right now or I want to order a pizza, something like that. I'm not sure which one it is. But they were chanting it out, their love on this little man. And that's how we recognized him, by the love. And that's how we are going to recognize Jesus too. We're going to have to get over our expectations, unlearn what we have learned, and look for the love. When we find that love, we'll be able to look at the old man in the wheelchair, wanting to give us some advice, or the checkout clerk that gives us a smile at the Safeway, or the blue-haired teenager with piercings all over his face who offers to carry our bag for us, or our friend who listens to our problems all night long, or our teacher who helps us with our homework, the nurse who cleans up after us, our parents who cook yet another meal for us. And when we look at them and the love they give us, we'll recognize it's Jesus. That's what worked for the two disciples today. Did you notice the moment they recognized him? Jesus sat down at the table with them. He took bread, blessed it, broke it, and gave it to them. The same actions he did at the Last Supper. The same love he showed us on the cross. That's when they recognized him. When they recognized the love. When they saw the love. This is the same love Jesus gives us today on this table, in this Eucharist. It's easy to miss that it's Jesus. Jesus can be pretty hard to recognize in this little piece of bread and sip of wine. But it's the same love, which means that it's God who is love.